What is going on, guys? Today I'm going to be talking about one of my favorite characters from Attack on Titan, Mikasa Ackerman. Now, a lot of people are probably already triggered by me saying that because, for some reason, a lot of people feel the need to hate on Mikasa. I've never really understood it myself. I think she's a pretty good character, but that's really what I'm going to be talking about in this video. I'm going to be defending Mikasa and explaining why not just is she a good, well-written character, but she is most certainly likable. Could she get a little bit more screen time? Maybe, but I mean, why take it away from all of the other excellent characters in the Attack on Titan universe? Could she be a more developed character throughout the series? Well, I suppose it's possible, but I just don't think that's what Isayama wanted to do. I think that she was pretty much fully developed as a character before the series even started in the backstory that we got to see from her. I'm not saying she needs to be your favorite character. I'm not even saying she needs to be in your top 20 in Attack on Titan. I'm just saying she does not deserve nearly the amount of hate she gets, and you don't need to be just an edgy teenager to enjoy her character. I mean, come on. I like her a lot, and my favorite character from Naruto is Obito Uchiha, and my favorite character from One Piece is Doffy. I'm like the least edgy guy ever, right? Speaking of Naruto, I'm actually going to be bringing it up a lot in this video because I think that there are a lot of parallels between the psychological states of Mikasa and Sasuke Uchiha. I know a lot of people are probably not going to like to hear that because, again, a lot of people don't like Mikasa, and Sasuke was almost always, I shouldn't say almost always, but about half the time, the number one favorite character of fans of the series. Which is really pretty unbelievable considering that for the majority of the series, he did not get that much screen time at all. He wasn't even in like half of the chapters at all, really. And by the way, just so we're all clear, I will be referencing the manga pretty much the entire time, so if you are an anime-only watcher, sorry, but that is very crucial when we're talking about Mikasa. So pretty much when she is a little kid in her backstory, before she's even met Eren, she seems to be a very nice girl. She's very cheery, she enjoys spending time with her parents, she seems very kind, just like a normal little girl, even possibly, like, better than normal. She seems to be living an extremely comfortable life with two parents who clearly love her quite a lot, and then out of nowhere one day when they're expecting a visit from Dr. Jaeger and Eren Jaeger, out of nowhere her dad is just dead in front of her. He just gets killed at the front door, and then when her mother tries to protect her, boom, she just gets axed, and it's all over. Then she gets taken, she's kidnapped, she kind of gets slapped around a little bit. Pretty traumatic, obviously. So, you know, after a little while, she's just laying there, bound up, listening to three older men talk about how they're going to sell her on the black market because she is half Asian. This is all happening to a little kid, by the way. And then, as we know, of course, Eren shows up and starts annihilating them in likes of which have never been seen before in this series. He just is this little kid with a knife destroying these older men. He kills two of them in pretty much no time at all. He helps Mikasa up, and then another guy shows up. Eren is getting pretty much choked out, and he does this thing. He tells Mikasa that she needs to fight. Him giving this little speech allows her to, with no exaggeration at all, awaken her superhuman abilities. That's not a joke. She actually is an Ackerman, which, as if you know you're caught up in the manga, of course, you know the Ackermans are a byproduct of Titan science, and as Levi and Kenny explain, if you are able to experience an event kind of like how it is with the Mangekyou Sharingan, obviously, or even the regular Sharingan, you can, like, unlock not really an ability with the Ackermans, but you're pretty much just like superhuman. In the way that Mikasa describes it, anytime she wants her body to do something, it just does it. If there's some kind of physical feat she needs to perform, she's pretty easily able to do it, no real difficulty. It's pretty much just having, like, the ultimate level of confidence while actually being able to execute it. But so yeah, after she awakens this ability and fucks that guy up, they just kind of, you know, they find Eren's dad and they're all chilling, and she's really sad, of course. Come on, both of her parents were just killed right before her eyes. I don't know why people just refuse to acknowledge that. But she's just sitting there and she says that she's like, she's cold. It's more of like a figurative type of cold. But then Eren, of course, wraps his scarf around her, and that becomes like her teddy bear on steroids, pretty much. I know a lot of people have a different idea of what the scarf means to her and what it represents. I don't want to be just like, yep, this is what it is. But pretty much the way I look at it, the whole speech she gives when she is awakening her abilities is that she realizes that the world is cruel. It's always been that way. She's just chosen to ignore it. And she's come to that realization clearly at this point. And then Aaron comes and just wraps this thing around her. So I think that pretty much that act made her realize that there still is such a thing as good, such a thing as kindness in the world, and she kind of just clings onto it as much as she possibly can. She then goes to live at the Jaeger house, where she kind of sees Aaron as like a brother, which is not really the case anymore, I guess. But, and then she has Dr. Jaeger and Aaron's mother, who pretty much are seen as like godparents to her. That's at least how I'm interpreting it. So that's very much family, at least I would say most people would agree. And they all get along, whatever, it's chill, you know, she's cool, she's willing to work and whatnot, as we've seen, Aaron's kind of a slacker or whatever when they need to get shit done, and she's fine with doing whatever, but they all hang out together, they become friends with Armin, they just live kind of a similar life to what she was doing beforehand, and then out of nowhere, of course, as we know, the Titans invade, Bertolt decides, you know what, fuck this wall, Reiner decides, you know what, fuck this wall, and the Titans start invading. Aaron's mom is killed right before Mikasa and Aaron, and this is after she's really unlocked her Ackerman abilities to some extent, and she was not able to help Aaron's mom. They tried getting her out of the rubble, but there's nothing she could do. So that had to be pretty heartbreaking for her, pretty much at this point, as we've seen with her attacking the bullies of the neighborhood and whatnot. She's pretty much able to do anything she wants physically, and then these Titans are just overpowering them so much. Aaron's mom is pretty much eaten before their eyes. Grisha is, I guess, presumed dead at this point. And she just has this reaction like, oh, this is happening again. Okay. I mean, she is at the point at this age, she's probably about 12 years old at the time, that if Aaron was to have died too, she probably just would have lied down and let the Titans eat her. Because at that point, not just what does she have to live for, but like, even if she does go and make some more friends again, which really is pretty unlikely considering the situation, it's just gonna happen again, right? That's what's going through her mind right now. It already happened once. Now it's happening again. If Aaron wasn't still there, there would be no chance for her. She would just lie down and die. But she still has Aaron, the guy that gave her that scarf, the guy that taught her that there is such a thing as kindness, as goodness still left in this world. There is something worth fighting for. So I think once you really consider the psychological toll that would take on a person, it's understandable how she is quite clingy to Aaron, and really, him and what he is doing is her top priority. She just wants to make sure he is alive. As long as that is the case, she is fine, she can keep on living. So now let's take a second to look back at Sasuke Uchiha. So to break it down quite quickly, again, Sasuke has a very similar childhood to Mikasa. He's just growing up in a family who's extremely loving. And on top of that, he is from an extremely powerful family, not just politically really, they're really not at all. But like, they pretty much have some of the craziest genes on the planet. The only people that rival them are the Senju, similar to how the Ackermans are extremely powerful. And I mean, really, the Awakening, again, works kind of like a Sharingan. There's quite a lot of similarity here. His entire family is also killed, with the little twist that it was his brother who did all of this, which again, we obviously find out later isn't the case, but that's not really the point at all. Pretty much, he has no one to really talk to about this whole situation. He kind of just keeps to himself for the next coming years, and he makes it his entire goal to just kill his brother Itachi. Unlike Mikasa, who decides to kind of just invest herself in Aaron instead of trying to get revenge, actually kind of similar to how Aaron does, how he just wants to kill all the Titans. She doesn't really like Titans either, she must enjoy killing them as well, but she decides to take the positive route and just kind of say, you know what, I still do have this, I'm just going to spend my life protecting this. While on the other hand, Sasuke pretty much disregards anything good in the world and just doesn't care what it takes to take down his brother Itachi. He's even willing to kill Naruto for pretty much no reason out of nowhere as soon as they find him in the desert. And don't get me wrong, I think that Sasuke is a brilliantly written character and I enjoy seeing him almost every single time he is on screen. I'm just saying that I can't really see how somebody could be so unforgiving towards Mikasa when Sasuke is such a popular character. You could say that Sasuke develops so much more throughout the series, which is true, but that's not really the point. I mean, why wouldn't he when you consider the fact that he finds out about Itachi, he ends up meeting all of the Hokages. I mean, all this stuff keeps happening to him that just changes everything. I mean, for God's sake, he finds out that he is, by all accounts, one of the two chosen people of that world. So it's like he has all these things going on around him that really shape him as a character. Where Mikasa, again, she has pretty much the same kind of backstory. There are some differences, of course, but it's very similar. And then as she keeps living on, pretty much just a less traumatic version of the same thing keeps happening. People that she does like keep dying around her, so why would she even develop? I think if she was to really develop, it would kind of take away from her character because it wouldn't make any sense. I've seen a lot of people get very upset about the part where Mikasa is facing off against Historia and Ymir when she's pretty much saying, like, so Ymir is obviously trying to stop me from taking Eren. I don't see how you could say that she's not justified in saying that she's going to kill Ymir. But then she says, I mean, Historia, if you're going to get in my way too, then I guess the same thing's going to happen to you. I know a lot of people don't like that, but I don't really know what you're expecting. I mean, again, first of all, let's just make this abundantly clear. Speaking from, like, humanity's side here, what exactly is she doing wrong? I mean, if Historia is really going to aid Ymir in preventing Eren's retrieval, then how is that really bad? I mean, that is the top priority. If they don't get Eren back, it's all over. Everything is over. They're screwed. But despite that, just some people can't take how she's just so easily able to say, like, I'm gonna kill my friends. I mean, again, like, you have to consider, she even pretty much spells it out for you. She's like, my enemies made deciding this easy 6 years ago. So, I think it makes perfect sense. Consider, I mean, really, if you were in a situation where you had to decide between, like, someone who you've been, I don't know, like, working with for the past 5-ish years, and someone who, not even just counting all, like, the dramatic stuff that happened, but someone who's pretty much a family member of yours for the past, like, 8-ish years. I mean, really, are you even going to hesitate to kill that coworker? I know there's more to it. They're not just coworkers. They are soldiers. They're like a family in and of themselves. But still, I really do think it's a very understandable situation, especially considering that Historia was low-key becoming like an enemy of humanity at that point. I would also like to mention, by the way, that when terrible shit is not happening to Mikasa or the people around her, she is a pretty nice person all the time. I mean, she was always seen smiling, being very kind around the Jaeger family. When she was able to protect the people from that Titan, and then eventually she had to stop from letting that cart have to get pushed through, she said, like, I'm gonna kill you if you keep trying to make these people push this cart. After that was all over, she, like, smiled to the little girl. I mean, that was a nice thing to do. She obviously does have a playful side, as we were able to see when she said that Sasha farted, and then in the same episode, we were able to see her, like, act like she was going to give a piece of bread to Sasha, and then she just sticks it in her own mouth. That was hilarious. When they finally make it to the ocean, she's seen just kind of, like, having a good time in the water. It's pretty funny to look at her. And then, even most importantly, very recently, upon Sasha's death, when they first heard about this, her and Armin ran over there immediately to see what was going on, and when they saw that she was in fact dead, I mean, Mikasa was like bawling, okay? So I understand that she was able to turn pretty quickly on Ymir and Historia, but that wasn't anywhere near a normal circumstance, and I'm pretty sure most people would do the same thing. When anything actually important happens that makes sense, like Sasha dying, she gets extremely emotional. She really is human, unlike what most people seem to think. So, you know, whatever. I mean, if you don't like Mikasa, that's cool. You don't have to. You can like whatever character you want. I just think she doesn't deserve nearly the amount of hate she gets. People say that anyone who likes her is just a total edgelord. I think it's ridiculous. I think she's pretty good. She's definitely not, like, the worst character in the series. Maybe I was able to change some of your guys' minds a little bit. If not, I don't know, maybe just as the series continues to progress, you're able to be a little bit more forgiving, cut her a little bit of slack. If you enjoyed this video, remember to give it a thumbs up and subscribe if you haven't already. Remember to leave me a comment letting me know what you thought about this video. If you thought it was pretty good, if you thought that Mikasa still sucks, I don't even know what the point of making this video was. I hope you guys have an excellent rest of your day, a good start to your weekend, and I'll talk to you on Sunday.